The world is constantly moving and evolving between the motions of politics and borders of our country. The culture of society changes. As different cultures interact and break apart from each other, new forms of art and thinking cultivate. Having a perspective on post-colonial architecture and urbanism paves the way for understanding architectural design in the modern world. Because post-colonial thinking reveals both the complex history of cultural hybridity and cultural independence of different countries and regions of the world, architecture tells a story. Especially in the post-colonial eras of many countries, architecture has a way of reflecting the history of colonialism, which ultimately reflects on the history of modern architecture globally. Post-colonialism, also known as post-colonial criticism, as a cultural phenomenon, it reflects the social status of post-colonial world today. Post-colonialism refers to three levels of social status in today's world. One refers to the contemporary situation of the former colonial society before the end of the year. Some colonial societies still had military, political, economic, and other rules of Western colonialism, and even colonial cultural rules and conditions. Second, it refers to the third world of contemporary social situations. That is to say, some former third world countries and regions, including pre-colonial and non-colonial societies, are dominated by Western cultural hegemony. Third, it refers to a global country that is cultural colonialism or cultural imperialism, which generally exists in the world after the end of the Western colonialism. Therefore, post-colonialism is mainly a kind of cultural discourse with former colonial and third world intellectuals as the main body. And it is a kind of cultural concern and cultural tendency of first and third world intellectuals. Its incense is to oppose Eurocentrism and cultural hegemonism of Western developed capitalist countries towards these developing countries, and to make their national culture return to its proper position from a marginalized state of the world culture, and even become a new cultural center. In the book of The Stage Handbook of Architectural Theory, the author critiqued the complex and insidious ways in which colonialism operated and the corrosive impacts it had on people and landscape. Colonial anxieties about purity of oppositional categories such as black and white, colonizer and colonized, modern and traditional, were encountered by increasing forms of hybridity as new ideas, people, images, and capital moved around the world with greater frequency. In architectural history, in professional education reflects on post-colonial challenges to the modern survey. The author Sybil Bosden said, "Architecture, which is an art form that has long depended on appeals to external authority, history, science, context, tradition, religion, philosophy, or style. That is to say that buildings, projects, and architectural ideas need to be produced in specific historical periods and locations under specific cultural, political, and institutional backgrounds."
He also said, "The point in architectural history is not to incorporate India, Chinese, Islamic, and other architectures into Western canon in some form of beginning tokenism, nor to discard the Western canon and replace it with the works of Northwestern others. Rather, the point is to show what side called intertwined histories. The East is closely connected with the West and is an inseparable pair of its own composition and identity. After a special period, the global history, culture, politics, and economy are inseparable, including architecture and architectural history. We can take India as an example as a post-colonial country. Since the end of the 15th century, with the opening of new sea routes, Western powers such as Portugal, the Netherlands, France, and Britain entered the Indian subcontinent one after another. In the 18th century, through a long-term colonial war for hegemony with its strong economic and military strength, Britain successfully included other European powers and established its hegemony in India. From the Battle of Piracy in 1757 to India's Declaration of Independence in 1947, the British ruled India for nearly 200 years. During this period, influenced by European colonialism, especially Britain, many excellent buildings were born in India. These buildings represented the power of the Syrian and became the symbol of its power and glory. Many of India's existing colonial architecture, whether it is the location of a project, facade design, or the selection of materials, architectural details of the treatment all vividly reflect the European architectural culture and art at the time. In the long years, the two architectural cultures of Europe and India consistently collide, some of which are excluded and some of are absorbed. But the final step is the integration between them. The process of architectural evolution is the epitome of this indelible history. There are various architectural styles in India colonial period. Among with the most influential ones are the following three categories. The first is a European style, which European architects, mainly British architects, used to adopt in the early stages, such as neoclassical, Gothic, Renaissance, Baroque, Byzantine, etc. The second is Indian saga, which combines European style with Indian Mughal style. The third type is the Virana style, which is produced according to the special nature conditions of India. These changes not only happen in the large scope of an entire country, but also in smaller systems like a city. The city is a form of settlement with a highly differentiated structure of society. Most cities have historical process of their information development. Take Qingdao, China as an example. The German architectural historian Linde wrote in a monography on Qingdao's colonial structure. German colonial architecture has been fairly well preserved in Qingdao. In contrast, the same periodic buildings in Germany have been renovated. The deputy mayor of Qingdao, Cao Zhaojin, said, "Protecting these buildings is an irreplaceable source for a nation and a city. The German European buildings in the old city are all historical and cultural phenomena. As a cultural language, architectural language can give us a lot of enlightenment and can tell future generations a lot. Therefore, protecting these buildings is a responsibility and obligation of our generation. Understanding these key perspectives in architecture and urbanism are necessary for understanding the makeup of our interconnected world. Colonialism is rarely a positive thing for the society that it suppresses. But nonetheless, it has contributed to each country's and an international history. It is factors like colonialism that shape a culture through resistance, solidarity, suppression, and independence. As these factors continue to shape modern society, we can watch the world of architecture change as well. As we move along, it moves along with us. After all, architecture tells a story."